Good morning. Wait, let me make sure everyone's awake. Good morning. All right, that's more like it. Welcome to the New York State Senate Elections Committee public hearing on voting rights and the administration of our elections. I am very excited to be here and to be joined by my colleagues who you will hear from very shortly. This is the second in a series of hearings we are holding statewide to examine the administration of our elections. I want to thank our majority leader for her commitment to our democracy and to the process of voting. We have made many strides in our majority, but we have more work to do, and it is not just in New York City. It is important that we hear from all corners of the state, and that is why we are here. I am very thankful that the College of Environmental Science and Forestry has opened their doors to us to have us this morning, and to bring greetings on behalf of the college will be the Chief Diversity Officer, Dr. Malika Carter.
Hello and greetings, everyone. Dr. Malika Carter, my gender pronouns are she, her, hers. On behalf of the President's Executive Cabinet here at SUNY Environmental Science and Forestry, or as we lovingly call it, ESF, we greet you. We thank you so very much for your time and attention today. Most importantly, we thank you for keeping our community safe. Just yesterday, we did receive a mandate to make sure that individuals who are indoors put on a mask to keep our community safe. So we definitely appreciate you doing that. I'm going to take the opportunity to tell you a very short story before you begin your conversational journey today. I was once sitting and watching a documentary, and this documentary was about taking the opportunity to help someone else. These individuals were gathering materials from their communities to take them to an indigenous village overseas. So they cruised overseas and they went to go give these things to folks. And so there was one woman who saw another woman with a family. What she did was she took what was given to her without even looking in the bag and gave it. She had given this indigenous person a whole bag, and on the top of the bag and the inside was a pair of red high heels. Just shout it out. What do you think that indigenous woman did with that pair of red high heels? Don't be shy. Okay, great answers. So what that indigenous woman did, because in her tradition, when someone gives you something that is red, because it was very difficult to make that color where she was with dyes, she thought that that was a way of her being honored. So she put food in those shoes and put them in the middle of her dining room table and invited that woman to eat. When the person came to eat, she backed up in disgust, not wanting to eat. And that indigenous woman was very, very disgruntled and hurt. So what she did was, when that woman left, she took those shoes, and I heard hammer over here, she used it as a hoe to till her ground and to create more food. And so the point of that, me telling you that today, is out of your conversations, please make sure that what you're doing is you're gifting not only yourself but other people something that they need, instead of us taking to communities what they don't need. So this is symbolic of what we're doing here today. And so I will hope that you keep that in mind as you do testimony, as you discuss, and as you think about what it is that our community needs. Instead of us thinking about it, as my grandmother said, all ideas ain't in one head. So what that means is that there's other people that are able to contribute. So I appreciate you being here, and we thank you very, very much for everything that you're doing for the community. Have a good time today.
Excellent, and thank you so much, Dr. Carter, for bringing those greetings, and thank you again to ESF for hosting us today. I will remind folks of what Dr. Carter just said. The policy is that you do have your mask on. The only exception for that is when you are speaking on the mic, if you so choose. So for all of our witnesses that are coming forward today, you can take off your mask to speak into the mic, but you are not required to do so. Before we continue, just a couple of housekeeping notes. I want to thank the staff that has made this hearing possible. A big shout out to my own staff, Edleen and Matt, who have been instrumental, but also a huge, huge shout out to the staffs of Senators Mannion and May, who have been instrumental in making this happen. I want to thank the Senate Central staff, Chris, Liz, and Andrew, for their work on this. And I want to thank the tech staff, who you would not be able to see this hearing today without. So huge thank you to Pete Dudley, James Soddle, and Lexington Fields. Now, I know we've had a slow news day over the past 24 hours in New York State politics. So everyone is waiting with bated breath to see our hearing this morning, and I'm sure we have everyone's undivided attention. But let me thank again my colleagues in the majority, Senators May and Mannion, for giving me the passport into Syracuse today, as well as Senator Rath. We're here for a very simple reason, and that's because voting is the right that protects all other rights. And while we have made many strides in this Senate majority from taking New York from worst to first, we still have a lot of work to do. And unfortunately, voters in Central New York are all too familiar with what happens when there are breakdowns in the administration of our elections and when the franchise is restricted and not expanded. We are, of course, in a national climate where we have seen legislatures all over the country move to restrict the vote. We've gone in the opposite direction here in New York, but we still have room to go. Unfortunately, in this part of the state, we had the dubious distinction of having the last congressional race called in the entire country. We will hear a lot more about that today and in the subsequent hearings. But part of the reason that we are here today is to look at what went wrong and how we can be better. So I don't want to speak for too long. I want to respect everyone's time. I'm going to allow my colleagues to give some opening statements as well. I will encourage us to be similarly brief as we are here to mainly hear from voters and other stakeholders in the process. So hometown rules, we are in Senator May's district, and so I will pass it off to my colleague, Senator May.
Thank you, Senator Myrie, and welcome everybody to the 53rd Senate District and to my alma mater, SUNY ESF. I have a master's degree from here. It's a wonderful school, and I'm thrilled that we're able to host you here. Yesterday, I was in D.C. I was one of about 130 legislators from around the country who converged on D.C. in support of the Texas legislators who have been there for several weeks trying to persuade the Congress to pass the For the People Act. And one of the things I said to people there, I said, you know, in New York, we had really terrible voting laws a few years ago, and we've been working really hard on that. But when you change things as fast as we have changed them, you also have hiccups and things that don't work smoothly. And so this hearing is about that, is about finding out how the changes we have made are working and how we can make them work better. And I really look forward to hearing your testimony today. Thanks for being here, and thanks for caring about our democracy, even on what is really not a very slow news day. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Senator May. We will next hear from Senator Mannion.
Thank you, everyone, for coming here today. And of course, a big thank you to Senator Myrie to make sure that not only are the voices heard, but they're heard throughout the state. There's nothing more important, as he stated, to our democracy than our elections. And I'm always happy to work with Senator May, but also want to welcome Senator Rath to Syracuse. I know we have spoken in the past, and he's a huge fan and happy to make the drive, so it's we welcome you. And also, thank you to ESF. I think anyone who is visiting knows what a beautiful facility this is, and I was honored to actually work in a volunteer program in a capacity for the American Chestnut Foundation with Professor Chuck Maynard here, for anybody who is familiar with him. A wonderful man, and does great work. So just briefly, I'd like to commend the election commissioners who were a part of the elections that I ran, and that would be in Onondaga and Cayuga County, Commissioners Sardo, Zarni, Heary, and Lacey. They did an excellent job, particularly during the 2020 election, where they so much had to be overcome, where much of their staff had to work remotely. They had record numbers of absentee ballots and had to absentee applications as well, voter registration. They did the work. It's certainly from the outside seemed seamless, where everything was pulled off in an amazing way. And a credit to them, because we have to stand up and push back against not just the messaging, but also the legislation that's happening around this country that is really destructive, that is calling into question the validity of our elections. So our elections commissioners and their staff are trained. They do a tremendous job. They put a high priority on making sure that every I is dotted and that these elections are certified. Any attempt to undercut what the importance, the messaging, the questioning of our elections is just irresponsible and destructive. And we cannot leave that legacy and that situation to our children. So I again thank you for doing this and for having me here today. And I'm anxious and interested to listen to the people providing the testimony, including those elected officials, the voters, and the people that do the work in our boards of elections. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator Mannion. And next we will hear from the ranker on the Senate Elections Committee, Senator Rath, who I understand is no stranger to Syracuse.
Thank you very much, Chairman. It is great to be back on campus. I graduated from Syracuse as well with a major in political science from the Maxwell School of Citizenship. And I now remember all the stairs that you have to walk when you traverse our campus. And it was talked about earlier about a slow news day. Well, hopefully we can capture some positive election reform headlines off of the discussion that we have here today. So I want to thank Chairman Myrie and my colleagues, Senators May and Mannion, for being a part of this discussion and everyone who's participating in this critically important conversation that we're having about elections and elections reforms in New York State. There is nothing more important, ladies and gentlemen, than ensuring that all New York citizens have faith in our voting systems. It is my hope that this committee will take its duty seriously and ensure that we hear from every region of the state and citizens across all of New York State who have different and diverse backgrounds. Most importantly, I hope this committee will reflect on what we hear and create proposals that actually address the challenges we have in our statewide election system. This is not the time nor the place to advance partisan politics. This is the time to address the real challenges with our election system. As my colleagues have heard me say several times this past year in the Senate, it is critically important that New York not simply pass edicts down to local administrators with no financial support nor knowledge of what those edicts will impact our local boards of elections and the work that they do to administer those elections. Far too often, our boards of elections and their hardworking and capable staffs are set up to fail. Voters deserve an election system that encourages participation and cultivates trust. Furthermore, this committee must take responsibility to correct policies that have only made elections processes more confusing. Restoring the integrity of our elections is extremely important to all of us up here, as well as all of us in this room. Whether it is intentional voter disenfranchisement, hundreds of ballots being found after ballot counting had begun, or the fact that some elections aren't decided until months after Election Day, it is no wonder why so many voters in New York don't believe nor trust our current system. Simply put, New York State must do better. Thank you again to Chairman Myrie for conducting these critically important hearings, and I look forward to hearing from everyone today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator Rath. So we're going to call up the first panel. Before we do that, I want to remind all of the witnesses that you will have 5 minutes to speak. We are going to try our very best to allow people to give the testimony that they so desire. I will encourage you, if you have submitted written testimony, to not come up and read that testimony. We will certainly take it under advisement and read it very closely, but to really speak and say things that you may not have captured in your written testimony. For my colleagues on the stage, we will have 3 minutes each to question witnesses. And for those who watched our first hearing, this hearing will similarly be focused on voters, but we will hear some testimony from local boards of elections. We plan to do a larger hearing in September where we will invite all of the boards of elections to come testify, but we recognize that size, capacity, and resources vary throughout the state. So to the extent that smaller boards would need this opportunity to speak, we have allowed them to do so. And with that, let me call up the first panel. So Charles Pierce L., Timothy Perfetti, and Max Ruckdeschel, if you could please make your way up.
Good
I believe Mr. Pierce L., whenever you're ready, you can start.
Good morning, Senators. My name is Charles Pierce L. I'm a native Syracusan. I retired 30 years ago from Chrysler. I'm also a partner of Greater Syracuse Neighborhood Association, and I also am the founder of Greater Southside Homeowners Association. And when I do that, particularly the Southside Homeowners Association, I also chair the voter education versus voter registration. Because if you educate somebody well enough, they're going to register to vote. And I think voting is very important, and I'm here constantly to ask you senators along the line that we got four early voting spots, and we need more than that in our neighborhood. In the neighborhood that I represent in the 4th District of Syracuse, we're the poorest neighborhood in the state of, our African Americans are the poorest neighborhood in the state of New York, which is crazy, it's ludicrous, because New York is the number one city and number one state in the country. We got Wall Street, so we got money. And, you know, I'm here to address and promote more voting locations, because we got two very important buildings right behind this university. We got Toomey Abbott, which is a senior resident. They took the voting out of there and put it up on Westcott Street. We got disabilities. There's disability people up there and a lot of seniors. Also, the Birch Street high rising. That's the same thing. They took the voting from those elders out of there, so they have no way, if they don't get any rides to go up there, they're not voting, they're not participating, because they have no area to get there, and we need those back for our people. We in the 4th District, we got over 12,000 African Americans in that district, and less than 4,000 vote per election, which is ludicrous. And in the last, I work with the woman leaders of voters. We meet regularly as well, and we go door to door in that area constantly. We increased the 8% from where it was in the last two elections. We increased the voting because we go door to door to educate. And I'm just here to take some questions from you. You heard, you know what I wrote and was wrote in the paperwork and stuff, and I'm just here to represent what I wrote and also answer any questions you guys might have for me.
Thank you. We're going to wait. Mr. Perfetti.
Good morning. Thank you for this opportunity to come and speak. I had submitted written testimony, and I would like to just highlight 4 points that I made in my written testimony to you. I am the Cortland County Democratic Chairman. I am also the vice chairman of the Democratic Rural Conference, which is a 47-county association of counties population 250 or less. I am a state committee member, and I am also the assistant secretary of the New York State Democratic Committee. So I'd like to think I know a thing or two about some politics. In my county, in Cortland, the commissioners are part-time. Due to positive election reforms passed by the New York State Legislature, this is no longer a part-time job. The legislature must amend the law so that all counties are required to have a full-time commissioner and one deputy commissioner. Point two is that when the legislation is passed to expand voter access, the resources must also come along with that. Money, the continual unfunded mandates. If we have training for members of the Board of Elections on a more consistent basis, and if the legislature determined some matrix based on population, number of registered voters, forms processed through the offices, or the number of election districts in a county. Use that matrix to determine a minimum number of employees that it would take to fulfill the mission, and do not allow local legislators to circumvent fulfilling these obligations under the guise of the strain to the county budget. The legislature should also be more time conscious when passing legislation. Sometimes that is an effect of when the governor will sign it as well, but some legislation comes down literally within 45 to 60 days before primaries, and then boards of elections have to carry out the mission. The third point I want to bring up is the bipartisan offices. These are the life jackets to ensure an election has inherent checks and balances. This allows both parties the assurance that the functions, duties of the office, and the elections are being conducted with each side having representation and ensuring equal oversight in the election process. My last point is a hearing that some reformists want to discuss making the office nonpartisan, somehow making it more professional. If you'd indulge me for a moment, I may be able to help illustrate how this would most likely turn out, because the reality is that no one is nonpartisan. Through a vast majority of rural New York, town boards typically are made up of four members that run in two staggered years. The boards are predominantly Republican-controlled, 4-0, 3-1, and very seldomly 2-2. And even by chance, if it is a 2-2 board, the town supervisor is a Republican, who is the deciding vote in ties. Those towns employ a code enforcement officer. This is someone who is credentialed, has had to pass a level of testing proficiency, thus appearing to be a nonpartisan professional. However, this individual is granted the position by the party in power who hired them. Now, Senator, this is not anecdotal. These towns pass sign ordinances, often dealing with political signage and how soon they can go out before Election Day. Regardless of these ordinances being ruled unconstitutional, not only by the state court, but by the United States Supreme Court, many times during election season, the sign ordinances start getting enforced with the code officer doling out citations that seem to selectively go to only the homes with Democratic signs. What would the homeowner most likely do? Fearing having to pay a monetary penalty, they pull their sign down. Yet, the houses with Republican signage go unsighted. I'm often asked by homeowners when I am made aware of this incident, how can they do that if they know these ordinances are unconstitutional? And I regretfully have to inform them that when there is one party rule, they believe nothing's illegal if you don't get caught. The end result, more often than not, is the homeowner takes the sign down. Not knowing their rights, not having the means or access to legal counsel, and as the justice system moves slowly, the remedy is usually only found after Election Day. All because a nonpartisan professional put in that position by the party in power told them that was how they interpreted the law. Now take this real example of nonpartisan and imagine running a board of elections whose mission is to carry out fair and free elections. I hope this could give you some perspective on the possible outcome of the law of unintended consequences. Thank you for your time today.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Max Ruckdeschel, and I would like to thank you for this opportunity to present voting in New York State. I would like to begin by recognizing all of the work that you have already done to improve voting and elections in New York State. Voting is much easier today than it was just 5 years ago. But with all of those recent changes, there have been some hiccups, and there are some improvements that I do believe that we could make. I'm testifying today as a private citizen, but I also have considerable experience with the voting process beyond that of most private citizens. I've interacted with many voters as a candidate for public office, chair of a local political party, and as a part-time employee of the Onondaga County Board of Elections. I would like to speak to the committee today from all these perspectives. I was born here in Syracuse, and I have been a lifelong resident of the state of New York. I registered to vote the year I turned 18, and I voted in every primary and general election since that time. So I'm quite familiar with the changes over the last 20 years to voting in New York. I remember voting on the lever machines. I remember voting actually not voting, but going along with my parents to vote when the polling site was in a neighbor's garage rather than actually in a public place before ADA rules. In 2020, we saw some things that worked great and some things that had some problems. Early voting was has been a marvelous success. I myself have taken advantage of early voting every time that it's been available. It was so popular, in fact, that in 2020 we saw for the general election the longest lines I have ever seen in Onondaga County at our six early voting locations for that election. Now that was unexpected, the first time it ever happened, and our County Board of Elections did a great job trying to adjust, adding hours, adding staff, trying to get people through as well as possible. But that wasn't enough. And for in future elections, I would recommend that the state legislature increase the minimum number of sites, early voting sites per capita for each county. Onondaga County had the minimum that election, and it wasn't quite enough. Just increasing the hours, it turns out I've watched people vote as an inspector, as a voting machine technician the last few years. Most people still come at similar times to vote. So increasing the hours at the beginning or the end of the day, we'll get a few more people, but you'll still have traffic jams in the middle of when everybody wants to vote. We really need more sites for more people to be able to attend. With COVID-19 allowing the absentee balloting for everyone was an improvement. I would definitely recommend. I know there's legislation out there and we're going to be voting on it, but definitely moving forward with allowing no excuse absentee voting for people, that will help expand the franchise. But as a part of that, as we saw, I was a part in Onondaga County, Senator Mannion, your race, counting the absentee ballots for that, where we ended up having a COVID exposure and we were shut down. And that was part of what took that race extra long time to get decided. We need the legislation to be able to count the absentee ballots before the election, which will improve the time it takes after an election is, after election day, for actually having it decided, and it won't push out into December before the results are certified. Finally, the last recommendation that I would make is just generally to funding. Elections are the foundation of our democracy, and we have to invest in them to keep them stable and to keep the rest of our democracy intact. Leaving the funding of elections up to county legislators and executives is insufficient. I would encourage either the state to provide more direct funding to elections, or to mandate minimum expenditures per capita on boards of elections by local governments so that they're fully funded. In Onondaga County, we run elections very lean, few staff, little money. We're very proud of it, but it makes it very difficult working conditions for our staff and for our election inspectors, and they deserve to be compensated and fully staffed. Thank you.
We'll start with Senator May.
Thank you. And thank you all for your testimony. Charlie, I wanted to follow up. It's great to see you here. I wanted to follow up with a couple of things because I wasn't completely clear. So you started by saying there weren't enough early voting sites in Syracuse. And then when you talked about Toomey Abbott Towers, for example, not having a poll, that's on election day, correct?
Correct.
So there's both of those problems, that we need more sites for early voting, is what you're trying to say. And we need to make sure that the election day polling places serve people who might have disabilities or otherwise.
Absolutely
need them
right.
To be closed. Okay. Just clarifying that because you had a lot to say, and I wanted to make sure that that was clear. And with Tim, I want to follow up about you. So you started by saying that there should be a full-time commissioner and a deputy commissioner in every county.
Correct.
But then you were saying there should be a Democrat and a Republican commissioner. Explain to me how these two things work.
Again, in speaking of my own county at this point,
We have a part-time commissioner on each side, Democrat and Republican, that act as a counterbalance to each other. But parroting what we're talking about, county legislatures trying to run elections on the cheap, they are both allotted one assistant who is titled senior clerk. It's less pay, and they lack the ability to carry out duties of the commissioner in their absence. Okay, so to mandate that each board would have one and one Democrat Republican commissioner, and each would be allotted a deputy commissioner, Democrat and Republican.
And then you meant there should be two full-time commissioners and two deputies.
Two deputies, yes.
Because you said one, and
I'm sorry, I apologize.
Okay, thank you.
And then beyond that, determine the staffing based on some matrix of population, registered voters, if additional staff were needed beyond that.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator May. Senator Rath?
Thank you, Chairman. My questions are for Tim and Matt. And my first question is with regards to the dozens of changes that we've seen to the elections law over the past couple of years from Albany. Just how difficult is it to administer elections based on all of these changes that we've seen from Albany over the past couple of years?
I would say from an employee standpoint, they haven't been particularly difficult. We do a lot of training. So that's where the breakdown usually ends up, is in when we get these changes. Okay, now we go out and there are hundreds of inspectors that have to work on election day. And that's usually either just election day or just with a primary. Those are the only 2 days a year that maybe they work as an election inspector. We have to make sure every one of them knows all of the new rules. And maybe they've been, some of these people have been working for 20, 30 years. It takes a little time for those new rules to get in. So I don't necessarily think that the changes have been particularly hard. There's so many hundreds and thousands of people across New York State that need to learn the new rules. It's just going to take a little time for everyone to get on the same page.
With my county, sir, again, it's in my opinion, and I can also say I stay in close contact with my Board of Elections, both Democrat and Republican. Okay, we're fortunate that we all get along, that it tends to come down to funding in staff and decisions sometimes made by the Board of Elections that, in my opinion, were sound decisions because of having to find polling sites with Wi-Fi capability. Again, legislators raised enough of a fuss to get the polling site moved to something they believe more convenient. Although it might have been more convenient for that town, it was not more convenient for the Board of Elections. My experience has been that a Board of Elections, let me say this, some county legislatures overstep their boundaries with Boards of Elections.
Okay. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Rath. Senator May for round two.
Sorry about that. Yeah, Charlie, I meant to follow up and ask you, do you have a recommendation of how many early voting sites there should be in the city of Syracuse?
We should have at least 10. We should have at least 10 with the population that we have in the area where voting is not being participated at in the low turnout that we have in our community. Not just on the south side of the city, but east side as well.
Okay. And just so you know, there are two now in the city of Syracuse.
Got it.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much. My question, I think, is mostly for Mr. Perfetti, but I welcome the other witnesses to chime in as well. I just want you to delve a little bit deeper into the notion that we should get rid of the partisan requirement. There's been a lot of discussion about this. There have been proposals about whether we should have a constitutional amendment to rid New York of that requirement. And I think you pointed to a helpful example of how that might not be helpful. But there are some folks who have seen, for instance, how it works down in the city, in New York City, where it's overwhelmingly Democrat, and you end up, we heard testimony from poll workers who were registered Democrats, but who have to, for purposes of meeting the bipartisan requirement, work as a Republican, so to speak. And I'm wondering if you have any response to that or thoughts about that dynamic.
Unfortunately, the only thought or response I have about that is, I'm probably going to botch the saying, but I think it was Winston Churchill that said democracy is the worst form of government, but we'll stick with it until something better comes along. Mm-hmm. And it is, I think the misnomer for the general public is that because commissioners are chosen by party chairmen, that they believe that's partisan. Okay, and I think we're all adult enough here in the political world to know that that is a function of political parties to choose their chair, all right? But chairmen are also elected officials along with their committee members who've gone through the petitioning process. And I know at least in my county, my chairman needs to be approved by my committee before I can forward that name to the legislature. And even in that case, and it's happened in places across upstate New York, where one-party-dominated legislators have rejected the chairman, the commissioner put forward by the opposing party. To me, those are very dangerous things, that a bipartisan office is one where the two major parties, and I know we have four parties, so I'm not here to talk about the Conservatives or the Working Families Party. But of the two major parties, our ability to appoint our people to serve in that office act as a check and balance upon one another during the election. To me, that is bipartisan. Did that answer your question, sir?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to address that as well. I agree with Mr. Perfetti's statement earlier on. I don't think nonpartisan truly exists. I think it's just in today's day and age, it's too difficult for any person to actually be nonpartisan. What I have seen as a part-time employee of the Board of Elections that I never quite realized before I had that position was just how truly bipartisan the Boards of Elections are as they currently are set up, and how well that can work, and how well it does work in Onondaga County. When we work on any part of the elections, employees are working in bipartisan teams, so there's always a Democrat and there's always a Republican together, right from setting up the election to counting the absentees afterward, and then on election day with the polling inspectors. And I can tell you from the staff's perspective, it isn't, we're not there to get my candidate elected, and you're not there to get your candidate elected. It really is to operate the fairest election possible according to the rules, get every vote counted. And I have to say that bipartisanship does work, it can work, and I would not suggest that New York State get rid of that and to go to try and go to a professional, nonpartisan approach that I don't think would work.
And may I ask, I'm sorry, never mind. Who would remove, as it stands right now, once a commissioner has obtained their appointment, the only person that can remove that commissioner is the governor. If we went to this mythical nonpartisan system, or even worse yet, civil service, what would be the mechanism then to remove the overseer of the office if they were found to be a bad actor?
Thank you. Senator Mannion.
As far as that question goes, I don't think Senator Myrie was directing that. I think that question is one that is important and needs to be answered and followed up on. Before this panel goes, I felt it necessary to make commentary on a couple different things that were addressed. And one is that as far as the number of early voting sites and changing the threshold at which the number of registered voters are enrolled for the number of sites, that legislation has gone through and passed and has yet to be signed. But then also I have a bill, S6684A, which has a per capita number for the number of beyond the two appointed election commissioners that per 20,000 active registered voters, that there's additional staffing of two people for each of those. So I wanted to provide that background and the commentary within this panel.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And then Senator Rath, very quickly.
Yes, I promise I'll be very quick. I want to thank Charlie for your comments about early voting locations, because I think that is a challenge, not only in urban communities, but also in suburban communities, as well as rural communities. And particularly in rural communities, some of which that I represent, rural counties, where people have to travel an hour to an hour and a half each way for early voting. And we need to make sure that we're looking at early voting locations across all of New York State to make sure that everyone has the opportunity to participate if they want to vote early. And certainly in our rural agricultural communities, it can be very, very hard with one polling location and a long distance to travel. So there's work to be done, but I appreciate you bringing up your comments.
Thank you, and I appreciate your answer as well.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Rath. And to the panel, thank you for your time and for your testimony.
Thank you.
Next up, coming to the stage, will be John Deere, Dr. G. Jeremiah Ryan, and Mark Spotifor. Mr. Deere, whenever you're ready.
Hello, Senators. My name is John Deere. I currently serve as a town councilor in Manlius, New York, and I've been involved in local elections since 2017, many times as a candidate, oftentimes as a campaign worker and staffer. My testimony today is to highlight the incredibly effective system that our local Onondaga County Board of Elections uses to make access to voter data extremely easy and accessible. In 2018, I worked on a congressional race where I was working with neighboring counties, and one of my jobs was to get in absentee ballot applications, something that's important for campaigns to be able to do, to interact with the folks that will be voting by absentee, because that does change quite a bit of the process in the campaign. Working with the Onondaga County BOE before the new system was in place was already the easiest to work with. They had the best data, it was reliable, and at a certain point I was told I will just get it every day rather than having to request it. With the new system, it's self-serve. I fill out a form saying that I won't share the information with the press or use it for any commercial uses, and I have full access to the entire voter file, so I know every single voter, I know their voting history, and I know whether or not they request absentees. As we get towards elections, voter absentee applications, ballots received, at some point pictures of envelopes are received. These are all things that campaigns find critical. As we just saw in 2020, Senator Manion, with your election, you know, the absentee process is enormous, and now it's even falling on candidates to ensure that the ballots are filled out correctly so that they can't be challenged. I know during 2020, I had residents in the town of Manlius whose ballots were being rejected for stray marks and whatnot, which if you tell a voter that they voted and because they dropped their pen on their ballot, that their vote doesn't count, it's pretty frustrating for folks. So now, with the Onondaga County Board of Elections, I can access all that data. It's all easy to access. It's updated daily for early voting. It's updated multiple times a day. And when we are in a situation where we have, especially in these off-year elections, pretty terrible turnout across the board, and there's not a ton of work being done by the state to turn voters out, that falls to the candidates. In these off-year elections, well, if they don't have the buy-in from big moneyed interest to afford very expensive proprietary systems, or if they don't have the blessing of a major party who has access to those voter systems, these grassroots candidates, really, if they don't have the access to the data like we do in Onondaga County, they're gonna be flying blind, which already makes it more difficult to win an election when in a year like this, you might only have every other voter turn out. And the job of turnout falling to the candidates is I think, inappropriate. You know, it shouldn't be on the people who want to serve to turn these folks out. We should be doing more. I think vote by mail is the pinnacle of voter access. Getting your ballot in the mail and then securely sending it back is the best system, and we should be working tirelessly towards that. But that being said, the Onondaga County Board of Elections and the systems in place here should serve as a model for the rest of the state, because they are always pushing forward to make that data more accessible, and it's absolutely crucial to these local elections especially. And another thing, I know the previous panel spoke a bit about it, but the bipartisan Board of Elections is something as well that I think is essential, because whoever it is, and I work with candidates across the aisle sometimes, knowing that there is someone there that you can trust at least to meet you halfway, that you don't have to worry about talking to someone of the opposing party who may have other interests, it's really important, and it means that you can trust your Board of Elections. And at the end of the day, they're the ones that are administering the election. If we can't trust them, we're in a pretty tough spot. And I will say too, talking about the Onondaga County Board of Elections and the work that they do, this is something that should also, we should find a way to do this for village elections. If those elections are going to continue to happen in March in a lot of these places where you have turnout that's less than 10%, and you have a election that is completely run by the governing body, which tend to be, even though they're nonpartisan, controlled by one major party, it puts the opportunity for candidates to run and have their voices heard, it undermines it completely, because you might have a village clerk who was appointed by a fully partisan board who, when you ask for voter history and who votes in the village, what are the odds that we're going to get that? And that vote, that data is owned by the villages. So moving to get the Board of Elections to control those elections and ideally move them to November with every other election, I think is also a priority.
Thank you. Dr. Ryan?
Mr. Chairman, thank you, and the other members of the panel. My name is Jerry Ryan. I'm the Democratic Election Commissioner for Fulton County, New York, which is in the foothills of the Adirondacks, just east of here. I'm also the Secretary of the Fulton County Democratic Committee, and I'm a member of the State Democratic Committee. I'm here to advocate strongly for the current bipartisan system, as you've heard several other speakers talk about. The bipartisan structure has been around for a long time. The New York State Board of Elections, for instance, has been in place since 1974, 47 years of working as a bipartisan organization that is the chief resource for commissioners of elections whenever they have a question. The bipartisan county system has been around for 125 years. It was started in 1896 as the result of the 4th New York State Constitutional Convention of 1894. That was a very reform-minded era, largely, I have to say, in reaction to the excesses of Tammany Hall. So they wanted to fix that. Bipartisanship works. It works because there's shared responsibility, there's shared administrative work, and there's shared governance. As other speakers have told you before, there's an ability to work together across the aisle in the bipartisan system that I believe the nonpartisan system that some have talked about would not afford. Now, having said that, I know there's been some recent problems. We've talked about what's happened in the 22nd Congressional District. Some would say there were some problems in the New York City primary this last summer. But don't confuse operational problems with bipartisan structure. I think the committee would do well to work with the New York State Board of Elections to encourage locally elected officials to address whatever problems exist. That may be money, it may be staffing, and I think the New York State Board of Elections working with you could help with that. And I would say that the New York State Elections Commissioners Association, of which I am a member, would be very happy to work with you as well on addressing those issues. Again, the bipartisan system works. It functions well. I would encourage you to support it and work with election commissioners across the state to strengthen it. Thank you. I'd be glad to answer questions at the time.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ryan and Mr. Spotiford. Please correct me if I'm saying, and that this is sort of a blanket statement. I am sure I will butcher some names. Please do correct me if I'm saying them not as you would like.
It's Spotiford, and that's okay, Senator Myrtle. So,
good one.
Welcome to Syracuse, Senator Myrie.
But seriously, I'd like to thank you for coming up to Syracuse and for doing this across the state. I think it's vital that we do hear from every part of the state. My name is Mark Spotiford. I'm the president of the Greater Syracuse Labor Council. We represent 40,000 union members in Onondaga and Madison counties. And I'm also, my day job is I'm the upstate New York political director for 1199 SEIU, representing 20,000 private sector health care workers in all of your districts. You, Senator Rath, at Comprehensive Rehab and Suburban Williamsville, Senator May, Mangan, Krause Hospital, Loretto Nursing Home out in Auburn. We have a lot of members in your district, Senator. And Senator Myrie, you know who we are. So, let me just say that I have kind of personal experience because back in my college days, I was a summer hire at the Onondaga County Board of Elections, which I don't think they do anymore. But I was able to work with a bunch of people my age, my cohort. There were Republicans and Democrats, and it was a great experience for me to learn kind of the nuts and bolts of how an election's put together. But I got there because I knew Assemblyman Michael Bragman at the time, and he's the one that recommended me to that office to work that summer. And everyone else I worked with was a son or daughter of a judge, or they had somebody in either party that was able to put them there. And the reason I say that is, one, it was, we all work together, and I think that having a bipartisan boards of elections can work and should work, especially from a labor perspective. We don't like one-party rule. To be perfectly honest with you, we like it when there is competition, because we find that if there is one-party rule with either party, that they don't have to listen to the concerns of labor. So for us, we do like the bipartisan nature across the state. So I think that's very important that we keep that as in place. The other thing is I cover a 36-county area as a upstate New York political director for 1199. And we have members in most counties in those 36. And dealing with 36 different boards of elections, you have a variety of different capacities, a variety of different ways of dealing with them and how they respond to you. I would say that my experience across those 36 counties is that they are underfunded. There's a lack of professionalism, just like basic kind of just customer service. And I would also say that there is a lack of cultural competency of trying to deal with, especially a lot of my workers, the private sector healthcare workers, a lot of them are lower wage workers who a lot of times haven't been exposed to basic civics and the process of voting. And I'll give you an example. I had a member who was working on our political program, working to get endorsed candidates elected, went in to vote and spoiled a bunch of her ballots. Because she did not, and I took for granted, and this is my fault. I thought she would know how to fill out a ballot, and she did not. My recommendation is, and one other thing I would like to point out, too, as far as professionalization, is that last year, during the 2020 election, I had a member who contracted COVID. She was diagnosed a week before the election. She was planning a vote on Election Day. And we literally had to threaten a lawsuit against a board of elections to make sure that she had the right, to get an absentee ballot so that she could vote. And it shouldn't have to take a big institution like 1199 coming out on the behalf of a member in order for her to vote. Everybody should have that. There should be a base level of professionalism and training across that state. So it doesn't matter if I'm working in a rural county or an urban county, there is a standard across the way. And the reason why we need this is that, the voices of our workers really need to be heard. The decisions are made, especially at a local level, all the way up to the federal elections, is so vitally important for what these communities look like, for what these, the investments that are made. And local communities cannot fund these themselves. This has to be part of the state of New York investing in a standard that all counties can lead up to. It's vitally important because this is the entry point for our democracy. And we've seen across the country, there are people who do not want to have that entry point being easy, and we should be open and welcoming to all people who want to participate in our democracy. Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Mannion, followed by Senator Rath.
This is a comment on Mr. Deer's comment about objections to absentee ballots as a since you are here, and although your testimony didn't reflect such. In Fulton County in 2020, did you see a record number, because we saw this in Onondaga and Cayuga County, did you see a record number of objections in that absentee count?
We did have a record number of absentees. The election before, we had roughly 400. During the 2020 election, we had 4,000. We had no objections to absentee ballots.
No objections to absentee ballots in
20? Either year, we did not have anybody filing any objections to any of the absentee ballots, and we had people from both parties come in and watch their counting.
Right, and zero objections.
Right.
Thank you.
Senator Rath.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you to all three of you for testifying and shining a light on some challenges and some concerns that we have. And Mr. Spadafore was brought up about training and a lack of training, and I agree. I think it's very difficult for boards of elections and the workers who are working on election days to carry out all of the new responsibilities with all the changes that have unfolded over the past couple of years. And I think that that training will continue to evolve and improve over time. And to your point about New York State encouraging more training and more professionalism, I think the BOEs have a high level of professionalism as it is right now. And I think they're really giving it their all. Mm-hmm. And many times they are struggling with funding challenges, as has been mentioned. They're struggling with the changes to election law, and the workers are then having a hard time explaining the changes to the election law. So I guess that's sort of an opening comment, but my question is to you, Dr. Ryan, and thank you, all of you, again, you mentioned operational problems do not equal problems with the bipartisan structure. And I agree, but could you maybe expound a little bit on what some of the operational problems and challenges that you saw in Fulton County are?
Well, the operational problems usually come up in Fulton County, or a small county. We just have 34,000 registered voters, so we're not like Onondaga, which has a lot more than that. Our operational challenges are usually new requirements that the legislature passes late in the session. The governor signs late, and then we have a limited time period to implement them, which we always do because we're dedicated professionals and we're going to get it done. I would say that the one caution I would give the legislature on behalf of many of my upstate colleagues would be one size does not fit all. You've heard a very articulate gentleman say that Onondaga County, especially the city of Syracuse, needs 10 early voting sites. We don't need 10 early voting sites. We need one, which we have.
Thank you. I have one question, and it's open to the entire panel. The notion of funding for our local boards is something that we talk about a lot on this committee, and just generally, the state legislature has allocated more funding for local boards of elections over the past 3 years. But I'm wondering if you can speak to any ideas you might have on how to restructure the process such that it isn't subject to the whims of the local legislature or the county budget. And whether or not you think there's some alternative that we could use, whether that is through the State Board of Elections or some other mechanism.
Well, I know NYSECA has supported legislation that, and it was talked about earlier by the county chair in Cortland County, where there'd be developed a matrix that would create a number of staff by voters, registered voters, which would help some of the smaller counties that are currently handicapped by perhaps having a part-time commissioner and a part-time clerk. And if there was some kind of minimum staffing levels that the legislature could work out with the advice and consent maybe of the New York State Board of Elections, I think that would be a step in the right direction. Now again, one size does not fit all. I'm retired. I have no intention of being a full-time commissioner. I'm a part-time commissioner, and I enjoy that role, which is not to say that we might not need additional staff if a matrix enabled us to hire support staff that could do the increasingly technical work that is required as a Board of Elections. I thank the legislature for the money it's given to us, especially in equipment, and we've been able to use that to upgrade, especially in cybersecurity, and also in e-poll books and those types of things. The legislature's been very good to us about that.
So I think in regards to, you know, how we help the local boards of elections, as we've seen with the new filing software that's gone out, that's centralized, and I think perhaps the data access that I was referring to could be more centralized, and obviously you probably don't want to put the New York State voter file up on a website for people to just download at wholesale, but there could be something done to basically, as you know, a voter in a district or a candidate in a district, get access to that, much the way the proprietary party-run systems work. And that would it would help significantly in rural counties, which I do have some experience with, where if you're looking to just get a list of voters without a major buy-in from a party, it's pretty difficult.
I would just add to that that the more the state can do to standardize, so in other words, you can have like centralized training for workers. And now you have centralized software. Whether there's a primary or election night, because I cover such a large area, I have all my screens set up with all these different boards of elections, with all the different systems. In fact, this year for this past primary, Onondaga, Erie County uses now the same system Onondaga does. And so I commented to the commissioner here how much it's like, oh, thank God, because their system was so horrible before. But I still have all these other horrible systems where I have to check voting returns and what have you. If the state could purchase that and offer it to the various counties so that they don't have to incur that cost, that would be very helpful. Because I'll say this, especially for a lot of my, the unions from on the labor council side, or even for my union from 1199, we want you to spend money on our members first. Then we start, we talk about, democracy and elections and things like that. So being a local legislator, of course, you're going to want to put the money into, say, roads, or you're going to want to put the money into, economic development or things like that, rather than the entry point for our democracy. So I think that the more the state could do to centralize and to standardize would be probably the best bang for our buck. Great.
Thank you all very much for your time and your testimony. Next, we will hear from Justin Polly, Laura Brazak, and Howie Hawkins.
Excuse me. Can I hand out something to the panel?
Sure.
Thanks. I thought about it after the fact. Sorry.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Appreciate it. Caller, thank you.
Justin, whenever you're ready.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Senators, for conducting this hearing. Thank you for allowing me to speak today. I wanted to talk mostly as my experience as a voter. When I voted for the first time, which I'm going to reveal my youth right now, I voted for the first time in 2008. I did not vote in New York State. Now, I proudly live in central New York now. I've lived here for over 10 years. I actually voted in Wyoming for the first time, in Jackson Hole. And usually when I say that, people reveal that I am the first person from Wyoming they have ever met. So hello. From Wyoming, hello. The other thing that people know about Wyoming is it's extraordinarily conservative. extraordinarily Republican specifically. It voted for Trump in 2016 and 2020 by nearly 70% of the vote. Last time it voted for a Democrat statewide was in 2006 with a Democratic governor. Democrats currently, I double-checked this yesterday, they have 9 seats in the state legislature out of 90. I am not a math teacher, I'm a social studies teacher, but that's 10%. They are extremely, extremely Republican in this state. And despite being often the most Republican voting state in the entire country, their election laws are surprisingly progressive, and they have a long history of very progressive voting law. Another thing that people might know about Wyoming, it's kind of that weird, you know, asterisk in the textbook, is that they were the first state, territory in 1869 to allow women the right to vote. And when they applied for statehood in 1890, Congress said, we don't know if we want a state that allow women the right to vote. That doesn't seem like something we want to do. And Wyoming responded by saying, we will remain out of the Union for 100 years rather than come in without the women. They allowed women on the juries for the first time ever in the United States. They had the first all-female town council, first all-female governor. The list goes on. The list is surprising how many progressive and forward-thinking policies and firsts that Wyoming has. Now, progressive policies regarding voting laws are strong across the Rocky Mountain West. And I feel that New Yorkers should look to the example of the frontier as we did regarding women's suffrage over 100 years ago. A couple of examples of what Wyoming does in their law and have been practicing for decades, if not over a century. They have had no excuse absentee voting for a very, very long time. My first election in 2008, I voted no excuse absentee voting. It was awesome. They have long practiced with very, very little controversy early voting. In terms of New York, I know we have implemented it. There's been a lot more expansion of early voting, which I 100% support. For me personally, where I live in the town of Onondaga. Onondaga Community College has been suggested as an early voting site. I 100% support that for two reasons. Number one, it gives an early voting site for the folks in Western Onondaga County. Number two, it gives an early voting site for the young people in Onondaga County who may go to school in that OCC but live somewhere else in the county. If they have that centralized location to vote during the early voting period, we might be able to up the participation in young voters, which I 100% support. Wyoming also allows, and this is something that I haven't heard as much in New York recently, they allow 17-year-olds to vote in primary elections if they will be 18 by the general. The idea is the primary is the precursor to the general. So shouldn't the 17-year-old voters be able to have a say in that primary if they are 18 by the general election? I would say yes. Again, New York is behind on this. They're getting better. There are a lot of policies that have been put into place in the last 2 years that have been incredible, and I've been very happy to see that since I've lived here over the past 10 years. But there is more that can be done, just like you said in your opening statement, Mr. Chairman. Good election law is not conservative. Good election law is not liberal. It's not Democratic. It's not Republican. It's just good. It's good for democracy. We in New York have an opportunity, while other states are stripping away these policies, to implement them. We already have the templates for all of them. Other states have already implemented these for decades. We have the templates. As we know, the states are laboratories to democracies. We should look to our fellow states, whether they be red or blue, whether they be large and small, for the examples of such good voting laws. I want us to take a page out of Wyoming's books. This is not about politics. This is about democracy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. Brazak, am I saying that correctly?
Yes, you are. Thank Great. You. Hi. Thank you for allowing me this opportunity. I appreciate it. I just thought of some stuff last night that I wanted to give you and did. To echo his statistics, that's a snapshot of what 47 counties in New York State look like. If you look down to Oswego, when this was printed in 2017, we had 20 Republican legislators to 5. In 19, we lost 3. We have 23 Republican legislators and 2 Democratic legislators. I rely, and thankfully she is amenable, on my Republican counterpart to go to the legislators to advocate for us as a whole, as an office. Our operating budget is about $1.1 million in any given year. Last year, we had $433,000 worth of grants, of which we spent, I think, all but $3. We had to issue a refund. That was a CTL grant from the Facebook people. I unilaterally put in a request to the Finance Committee for an additional $633,000 to be added to our budget this year, which isn't going to happen, and nobody even responded. I started 3.5 years ago. My first day was 10 days before a general election. Speaking about training, there was no training. I spent about 4 hours with my predecessor in his apartment, and I walked in the door and was it was baptism by fire. My deputy had only been a deputy for a couple of weeks. My senior clerk had only been a senior clerk for a couple of weeks. The senior clerk, deputy, and commissioner all retired within 6 months. Nobody really knew what was going on in the office. It was sort of a demilitarized zone down the middle. And I think that with regards to the bipartisan nature of this office, rather than demonize the other, we have made huge strides and worked together very well. Specifically for early voting, we put together a schedule with our warehouse people, our office workers, and the people, the poll workers. And the first day we showed up, there was lines down the street and around the block. Every single person on a schedule worked every day from ding to dong. We were there before it opened and after it closed. Because of the new reporting requirements, we had staff people, a bipartisan team, staying until midnight, uploading our voter history. We, in the 3.5 years that I have been there, one of our election record reporting programs has timed out. So we went to a vendor called Sage Smith, who provides us with that service. We have implemented electronic poll books. We still only use 8 of them, and we use them exclusively for early voting. We have 5 on-demand ballot printers. Having a second early voting site would double our expenses and be somewhat stressful for those people whose job it is to administer those sorts of things. The gentleman earlier took my line about Winston Churchill and democracy being the worst except for all the others, but I do think that when it works, both parties are being advocated for and both parties are being held to a consistency, which we still come up against daily. Somebody hands in a caucus a day late, I step up. Somebody wants a FOIL request without submitting a FOIL request, they say, no, we need a FOIL request. There's a day-to-day operations that I think, from opening doors, unlocking cabinets, creating ballots, that is best served in a bipartisan manner. Is there anything else I wanted to say? Early voting was exhausting. We actually had one of our warehouse workers eventually had a heart attack. Everybody worked every day, all day, and it was a tremendous example of bipartisanship. And doing those absentee ballot openings, we had both parties, both campaigns, we had people, it was like a concert. We had beverages, and we were there all day, every day until it was done. And I think everybody was happy with our outcome. So that's all I have to say for now. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Hawkins.
Thank you. My name's Howie Hawkins. I live here in Syracuse. I was a Green Party's candidate for governor in 2010, 2014, 2018, and the party's candidate for president last year, 2020. Now, I want to focus my testimony on improvements I think can be made to New York State election laws. But the first one has to do, I'm for nonpartisan election administration. What other credible democracy in the world has its governing parties administering their own elections? The only other one is Ireland, and they got a law to go to an independent elections commission. And we're in a situation where the credibility of our elections are being challenged by the Republicans with these state laws for voter suppression, election subversion, where the legislatures can flip elections, and partisan gerrymandering, with the U.S. Supreme Court saying, yeah, you can gerrymander for partisan purposes. You can have voter suppression laws for partisan purposes. So how can New York try to change this conversation around? Maybe have nonpartisan administration of elections. Because that's what the Republicans are doing. They're getting partisan administration so they can flip elections. And I can tell you from running for president, had three ballot access cases. And every vote on our cases was strictly partisan. At the Board of Election level, it was tied 3-3, which meant it had to go to the courts. And those judges voted strictly on partisan lines. Got knocked off the ballot in three states because of that. And I, you know, there's been a lot of good testimony about how good the Onondaga County Board of Elections is. And I agree, and I've had good experience with them. But I can't say the same for Greens around the state. New York City, some rural counties, for example, getting registration forms that have the Green Party on it after we got enough votes to be on the ballot. That was an issue both in New York City and several rural counties several times. So my second point is that we should have fair ballot access. The law that y'all passed in April 2020 makes New York the most difficult state in the nation to get on the ballot. But it's worse than any other country I can find in the world in terms of the number of signatures. We're off the charts. And I put a recommendation in there based on a bill that John Conyers introduced in 1989 to Congress, a study at Harvard, fair votes recommendations. Be much lower than what we have for statewide office, but it should also be lower for down ballot races and more than 6 weeks to get the signatures. There's no other state in the country that has that. It's at least 6 months. Well, Texas, not a real voting rights state. They got a shorter timeline. Every other state is over 6 months. Usually it's a year. Sometimes there's no limit. You just get the signatures, and when you're ready, you submit. So voting rights should include the right to vote for who you want. You know, for Greens, you know, we got a two-candidate, four-party system because we got two fusion parties that endorse the major party candidates. And, you know, just to remind folks, you triple the number of votes we need to get. It's actually more than triple, from 50,000 to 174,000 back in November. Double the frequency from every 2 years to every 4 years. Triple the signatures to get on the ballot. And quintuple the signatures in half the congressional districts. Now you got to get 500 signatures instead of 100. And that's how third parties get knocked off the ballot when they submit statewide petitions. So I really urge you to look at that. Last year, there wasn't one petition for president or any down ballot race successful that was more than 5,000 signatures, according to Richard Winger at Ballot Access News. You're talking about 45,000 signatures in a six-week period. And just to compare this to other countries, if you want to run as an independent for the Congress in New York, you need 3,500 signatures in 6 weeks. You want to run for the House of Commons in the UK as an independent, 10 signatures. New Zealand to their parliament, 2 signatures. India's lower house, 10 signatures. It's 50 in Australia. It's 100 in Canada. And here it's thousands, in some states tens of thousands, although there are some states that are more reasonable. Hawaii, a very Democratic state, and Tennessee, a very Republican state, is 25 signatures. So I think you can make ballot access reasonable instead of impossible. Third point, ranked choice voting. I think we should extend it to all the statewide offices. It's very popular coming out of this New York election, the Edison Research poll. 95% of the voters found the ballots simple to fill out, and 77% want to use it going forward. And I think we should extend that to ranked choice voting to get proportional representation in the legislature. That's ranked choice voting in multi-member districts, like New York City did from 1937 to 1945. Got their first black members of the council, first women members of the council. They had a multi-party democracy, 4 or 5 parties represented. That system was used for community school boards in New York City from 1969 to 2002. So we know about how to do it. And I think you need to think about how the single-member district winner-take-all system is exclusionary. In the district we're sitting in, I got 48% running for the city council. My people got no representation.
Mr. Hawkins, I did give you an additional minute if you could just wrap it up in the next 15 seconds.
Okay, well, studies show 90% of House districts and 95% of state legislative districts are uncompetitive because of this single-member winner-take-all system. And if you look at my written testimony, you'll see how it works in Australia. It doesn't matter whether it's ranked choice voting or plurality voting. If it's single-member winner-take-all, two parties are going to dominate. Last point is to deal with ballots and ranked choice voting and recognizing parties. You can go to aggregated fusion instead of disaggregated fusion. One line for each candidate with all their nominations underneath their name instead of every party has a line and then the candidate appears multiple times. So I ran against Cuomo. His name's on there four times. I'm on there once. It's a lot more complicated.
Thank you for your testimony. Thank you. We'll start with Senator Mannion.
Mr. Hawkins, thank you, of course, for your runs for office and for representing our region so well when you do such. I just wanted to give you a little more time. You can go back to whatever issue you'd like, but as far as ballot access goes and the changes that had occurred, you did a great job of articulating exactly what those changes were. What proposals would you suggest beyond just a return to those previous numbers?
Well, the numbers I put in my testimony was, and this is based on studies that I mentioned from the Conyers bill, a study at Harvard, and a fair vote. I think it was 10,000 signatures, 50,000 votes, and also 10,000 members registered in the party, which about 10 states use for ballot qualification. So it's another method. And yeah, those are the numbers I recommended. And like I said, it's much higher than most countries, but it's sort of in the middle of where US states are. And I think it would be a lot more reasonable than what we got now, which as far as I can tell is the most difficult anywhere in the world in any credible democracy.
Thank you.
Senator May?
Yeah, Howie, thank you so much for your testimony and for making this case. This is something my colleagues know that I've been pushing very hard for, making it easier to get on the ballot. Especially, honestly, in rural districts where it's very hard to go door to door and get with paper signatures that, you know, I've been advocating for electronic petitioning. I've been advocating for much lower numbers. And sadly, what you find is incumbents are very loath to make a lower barrier to getting people on ballot. But I did want to go back to the beginning of your testimony about nonpartisan election administration, because in theory, I agree with you that the parties should not be, that you shouldn't be selecting two parties that are in charge of the elections, because then those two parties are going to have a lot of power. But you heard from Mr. Perfetti about how, no matter how sort of professional you try to make the administration of an election, partisanship is going to seep in from whoever's in charge of appointing the people who run the election. So I'm just wondering, what is your, or where is there a model that you know of where they do this well in a way that actually does end up being nonpartisan in the administration of an election?
Well, I put links to a number of these election commissions. In Canada, they give it another name. And Canada did it because they had a problem with partisan election administration 100 years ago. And so the links are there to their websites. And, you know, being nonpartisan, it's an aspiration. And if the board is supposed to be that way, at least you got a standard. You know, now with the partisanship, you know, just taking those voter registration forms, you know, Greens would go in there and say, we're supposed to be on this form, and They just got thrown out of the office, basically, by, you know, in a rural district, Republicans, and in New York City, Democrats, even though they were nominally bipartisan.
Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Rath.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you to all three of you for testifying and giving us your perspective. Laura, I want to follow up on something that you had brought up, and you said you're Oswego County, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I think what we've seen over the past couple of years is a tremendous amount of change to the election law.
Correct.
And many
about
unintended.
100.
I'm sorry?
By my count. About 100 by
there
my
you are.
Count.
Many is definitely 100, that's for sure. and unintended consequences that have been outcomes of these changes to the election law. One is the cost that is now a tremendous burden on our boards of elections. Doesn't matter if it's an urban board, a suburban board, or a rural board of elections. And this year in the budget, we passed and we approved an allocation of $25 million mm-hmm. for boards of elections across New York State. Mm-hmm. If you take that across all 62 counties, that's $403,000 per county if you divide that up equally. Mm-hmm. You said you had a $600,000 shortfall or request that
yes.
you had needed.
We have 35 poll sites. Six of them don't have internet. We're the largest geographic area. We have a problem trying to find a building that's ADA compliant. I mean, that leaves churches and schools. We utilize 8 electronic poll books. Our recording is problematic at the backside because we have to do the paper poll books manually, but we can upload the electronic poll books quickly. So there, we have, of that $25 million, our share was $24,000 for the EVE program, and it was $114,000 for the TIER program, which is all the technology issues. There is discussion regarding online absentee ballot tracking. So if you vote by absentee, you can track your ballot through the system. That's $48,000 through one of our outside vendors. Plus, you have to subscribe. So you pay every year, and those costs go up for software upgrades, support. So it's minimum $48,000 to implement working with the State Board of Election and NTS and our office. I don't write code. I don't understand a lot of what we do. I understand a lot of the data entry, but I do not understand how these programs mesh and the problems they encounter in the DMV with the state, with our office. I would also just like to say that this year, this calendar year, 2021, I just got Windows 10 on my computer. So some of the rural counties are not positioned to accept these challenges, even, you know, even though they're well-intended. The implementing them in a lot of ways is, I mean, that's my job. I try to put my head down and administer the election. The big picture theory stuff is not in my purview, but just implementing those various systems and training. And my clerks, me and my Republican counterpart worked for a year to get them raises because the clerks can make more in fast food, in Walmart, in any number of areas. You can pick a car or an apartment. So, I mean, I would just like much more money, much more training, much more technology, much more assistance. I know that there's a survey going around for rural internet, as internet is part of infrastructure, and just things like that would help immensely us administer an election, just the nuts and bolts of it.
Well, Laura, I just want to thank you for that very specific and sort of granular explanation of the challenges that you have in Oswego County. And you all, doesn't matter which county it is of the 62 in New York State, is asked to do much more with significantly less.
Yes.
And this is an unfunded mandate, and there's so many that are suffocating our counties. And this is an example within our boards of elections. I give you credit and everyone who's here to try to fulfill your responsibilities with not enough state resources. So thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Senator Rath. A comment on Mr. Polly's testimony regarding the 17-year-olds. My understanding, and I may be wrong, but I believe a number of my colleagues have introduced bills to this effect. I think it's something that we have moved in our committee, and hopefully we can get some movement in the assembly as well. But I very much believe in allowing 17-year-olds the right to vote in a primary. And that's something we'll be pushing for. As you know, we passed in 2019 the pre-registration of 16 and 17-year-olds. And so we are moving in that direction. Ms. Brazak, I'm hoping you can speak to what you believe. There's been a lot of coverage, both media coverage, public discourse about what happened in the New York 22nd.
Yeah, we were there.
And I'm hoping that you can speak to what you believe were the problems and the impediments and the challenges to ensuring that everyone could participate fully in that race.
It is my understanding that a lot of the problems occurred with the portal and just registering people to vote timely. As I said, we had a schedule. It went out the window. Everybody, both sides of the aisle, everybody's there, ding-dong. We brought in people. Just filing absentees by district took a considerable amount of time for an office our size. I don't think any of that was a result of any sort of structural bipartisan model, management model of the office. I think in a pandemic, I think they just got behind the eight ball. Now, I am of the opinion that there had to have been a lot of people who knew what was going on, and they just got buried under it. I don't think that there, never attribute to malice what can be explained by stupidity, or overwork, exhaustion, whatever. That was an unfortunate situation. Again, that probably could have been handled if they had resources. I mean, a couple of nights you stay until midnight, data entry, carrying bins back, filing, and then you got to get up the next morning and the polls open and you just get exhausted. I don't know what the remedy should be other than we need more resources, more boots on the ground, and people to pick up the slack when you get, I mean, nobody, I did not see that coming. That was my first presidential as a commissioner. So it was quite a, I blank some of it out, PTSD, but it was exhausting. And I feel bad for Oneida. I'm glad it wasn't us. I'm glad we kept up. I'm glad, you know, we had 80-year-old retired poll workers in there filing our absentee ballots and pushing machines up and down hallways. And it was really a tremendous effort. Unfortunately, Oneida seems to have fallen short in just a lot of that. I don't think changing anything structurally would have helped that.
So you feel it was just a sort of understaffing, overwhelming?
Well, in our office, if something's wrong, we own it immediately. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, we're in trouble. What do? We got to fix this. We own it. We try to rectify it. It makes us, I mean, there might have been some reluctance to call for help earlier when it would have mattered. I don't know what the level of awareness on both sides was, or whoever was doing the actual work. We really rallied. I feel like band of brothers after, you know, our office survived what was a very exhausting. And then it went on. I mean, it went on and on and on. So it was mentally draining.
Thank you very much. And thank you to the entire panel for your time and your testimony.
Thank you.
Next up, we will have Michelle Lefebvre, Marissa Fournier, and Mary Jensen. So I don't think Michelle is here, but she was going to speak on behalf of the Jefferson County Board of Election.
I'm Michelle.
Oh, you are. Okay,
yes.
Great. Marissa.
I'm Mary.
You're Mary. Mm-hmm. So we're just missing Marissa. Okay, we will have a panel of two. Mm-hmm. And Michelle, whenever you're ready.
My name is Michelle Lefebvre. I am the Democrat Commissioner for Jefferson County. Just as a little background, I started out in 2004 as an elections inspector, and then I was just appointed last August to the commissioner position. I want to make, I just want to point out two things. Having our office set up in a bipartisan manner works for us. It provides checks and balances, and the voters can see that it's not just one side or it's not just one idea or one issue that's being pushed. We are there genuinely for the voters, and we have their interest first. Because of that, the voters in our county have faith in our office. With everything that happened last year and in the last general election, for the first time ever, we had lines for our early voting. And we had voters that waited in line for over an hour and came up to us afterwards and thanked us for the job that they did because they knew that their vote was safe and secure and it would be counted. That I can't put into words how much that means. As far with the early voting expansion of the poll sites, as it was said earlier, it's not a one size fits all. As I mentioned last year, it would have been great if we had had more than one early voting site. This year, it doesn't make any sense for Jefferson County. Last November, we had about a 73% turnout rate. This past June, for our primary election, we had 4,000 voters come out. We have approximately just a little over 63,000 voters in Jefferson County. So our numbers are really low when it's not a federal election. And we don't have the money in our budget for that. And with the numbers as low as they are, we just don't have them. And I'm sorry, I'm very nervous.
You're doing great. You're doing great.
I also, just going back to the bipartisanship of the office, I'm very fortunate that my counterpart, Commissioner Seymour, is great to work with. He's helped me out a lot. But I think that having somebody that represents the two biggest parties in our county allows the voters somebody that they feel that they can come and talk to if there's an issue that they have, whether it's something they have in common with us, or whether they'd feel comfortable going to one over the other because they have a problem with an issue that is going on right now. The way that our county is structured, 14 out of our 15 legislators are Republican. We have one Democrat. Our three members of assembly are Republican. Our Congresswoman is Republican. Our state senator is Republican. So if we have a Democrat voter in our county, I'm one of the people they can reach out to, and having, you know, me be available to them, even though they're going to get the same answer from me that they get from Commissioner Seymour, they feel more comfortable with that. And I think that that is essential in having faith in our boards of elections. Aside from that, with all of the mandates that have happened and that are continuing to happen, our biggest problem is the funding for it. As I mentioned earlier, on the off-year elections, when it's not a federal race on the ballot, our turnout is very low, and it's hard to get the legislature to take the money that we need to run these elections and make it easier and more accessible for the voter when we don't have the numbers to back it up. So, thank you.
Thank you. Great job.
Good morning. My name is Myrie Jensen. I am not here representing anybody other than a voter from Manlius, New York. I have lived in the town of Manlius for the past 21 years. Prior to that, I lived in the town of DeWitt for a while. In all, I've lived in central New York for more than 32 years. I read a quote yesterday from Senator Sheldon Whitehouse, and he said, "The most precious of American gifts is the vote." I agree with him. And I understand, and first of all, I'm grateful to all of you. I'm grateful that this is bipartisan. And I understand that you are not giving me the right to vote, that you're basically guarding it at this point. And I appreciate your efforts, as I appreciate the efforts of the Onondaga County Board. I'm grateful that they're a bipartisan commission as well. I'm grateful for a lot. I'm also very concerned. I'm here today, not because I'm grateful, but because I'm concerned. I want to talk to you about voting in this county. My husband is an immigrant, and he's very proud of the fact that he's an American citizen and can vote. So he and I went out on the very first day of early voting, and we stood in line for 2 hours and we met this lovely elderly couple who are from Greece. So I stood in line with three immigrants for 2 hours, and they were elderly. So my husband and I are in our 60s. So when I say elderly, I'm talking way older than us. Okay.
More mature.
So I just want to give you the picture, right? So we're in, it's cold, it's rainy, the wind is whipping, and we're in line for 2 hours because that's how it's set up. And why? We don't have to do, that's silly. We need more early voting sites if we're going to keep this. We need more early voting sites. My next concern is the problem of partisan gerrymandering. I'm most familiar with it in Onondaga County. I was shocked to find out that there are 33,000 more registered Democrats in Onondaga County than Republicans. I had no idea, because Republicans have been in charge of almost everything for more than 30 years, right? I remember, had to be about 20 years ago, I went to go vote in a Democratic primary. So I pull up to the bowling alley, which is at the time where we voted. My brothers loved that you could bowl a game, get a beer, and vote all at the same time. They thought that was brilliant. So I go to vote, and it's 7 o'clock at night, and I'm like number 17. And I said to the woman who I was signing in, I said, please tell me. This is like many sheets later, right? Because it's 7 o'clock at night. And she said, no, you're number 17. And I was like, my God, that's a support group. That's not a political party. What are we doing here? And that's when I just thought there's so many more Republicans, which is why everything was going to the Republicans. And then I do a little research and find out, no, there's more Democrats, right? So, okay. There's Republicans outnumber Democrats in the county legislature here, 11-6, despite the fact that there's that many more Democrats in this county. Prior to the 2019 election, 9 people running as Republicans signed a pledge that they would end partisan gerrymandering here. So, right, they sign this pledge, they get elected, what do they do? Oh, well, we didn't really mean that. We're not really gonna do that. We just signed this pledge for you all. Colonel Vindman, he's right. Right should matter here. Your word should matter here. I want it to matter in Onondaga County. I want it to matter in New York State. I'm tired of this. As a voter, I am so tired of this. You guys get elected, and I'm not talking about you because I'm sure you're all lovely, you're here. But people get into government, they get elected, and then what does the game become? Staying in power. And then you know who loses? Me, the voter, my family, my children, everybody I care about that lives here. We're the ones that lose. This is a game that's not fun to those of us who aren't playing. And I don't know how to say that in a way to get it through to people's heads, but we're tired of this. We are so tired of this. There are 6 districts in Onondaga County that have more Democrats than Republicans, but have a Republican legislator. 6. Manlius, where I live, is one of them. I want you to look at 2 little towns, town of Manlius, town of DeWitt. I lived in both of them. Manlius has a population of 32,000. DeWitt has a population of 25,000. There's 49 square miles land in the town of Manlius. There's 33 in DeWitt. Manlius has 5 zip codes. I don't know who determines zip codes, but Manlius has 5 of them. DeWitt has 1. DeWitt has a town supervisor who's a Democrat. Manlius has a town supervisor who's a Republican. DeWitt is broken up, gerrymandered into 5 legislative districts in Onondaga County. Manlius is 1. This is nonsense. This is nonsense. And as a voter, I'm letting you know, I'm tired of it. I am so tired of it. And finally, I've been listening carefully to all of this. I don't represent anybody. I don't know all the intricacies, the nuances, the little things that go back and forth about voting in Onondaga County or New York State, but this is what I do know. I have a daughter who lives in Seattle. 2 weeks before every election, she receives in the mail a ballot. With that ballot comes a little booklet that describes everybody running for every office and every initiative that they're being asked to vote on. She has 2 weeks to then return that ballot in the mail, and it has a tracking number on it, so she's not worried about that. She has 2 weeks to look up every initiative. Do you know how many times I've stood in a voting booth reading and rereading an initiative to make sure I'm voting the way I want to vote? This is crazy. This is 2021. We can do better. I've been to Seattle many times. They are not smarter than we are. We can do this too. We can do this. It can be cheaper than what we're doing. We don't have to have 80-year-old people opening file cabinets looking for things. We can do this. We can absolutely do this. And I got to tell this because I'm a social worker, and there are so many other things I worry about in Onondaga County. I worry about the fact that we have the second highest rate of babies born with neonatal abstinence syndrome. For those of you that don't know, that's babies that are born in withdrawal from an opiate. We need to be spending time on that and not on the nonsense that's happening when somebody's going to feel good about themselves because they outsmarted somebody else in a gerrymandering situation. As a voter, I'm tired of it, so I'll stop now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I will say that I have a special appreciation for your testimony just as a voter. That is something that that's sort of the purpose of these types of hearings. So I'm very grateful for your testimony, and also for you acknowledging New York's supremacy over Seattle, which I think is something that Senator Rath and I can both agree on.
100%.
Any questions? I want to thank you both very much for your time and your testimony.
Thank you.
Okay, next we will hear from Eileen McCombie, Agnes McCray, and Michael R. Verdell. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'm assuming neither of you are Michael. Or, oh, okay, all right. So we'll go with this panel of two, and we will start with Ms. McCombie.
Thank you for allowing me to speak today. I come from strictly a voter perspective and a situation that took place at the voting poll that I was at. I have lived in East Syracuse since 2015, and my polling place has been St. Francis Assisi, located in Bridgeport. On the morning of November 3rd, I arrived at approximately 6:30 a.m., as I usually do. When I provided my name and address, no ID was required. They identified me in the book, had me sign electronically. I went to the next table to receive my ballot. At that point, I was given a ballpoint pen. I filled out my selections. I went to the scanner and found a gentleman standing next to the scanner who said to me that it was not working. I asked him, was there a backup? He said there was not. I then said, you've known it's election day for how long? If we want free and fair elections, how do I make sure that we achieve that? He shrugged his shoulders. I then asked, what am I supposed to do? He hand gestures to me to pull out the bottom and slide my ballot in there. I said to him, how does it get tallied? I said to him, this isn't trustworthy to me. And he said, well, you can come back later if you want. I said to him, and who's to say at that particular point that the ballot machine is going to be scanning. He says, I don't know what to tell you. So at that particular point, my choice was leave, and I've never been in a position where I was to cast my ballot and not have the scanner working. So can I leave? Can I leave with my ballot? Do I come back with my ballot? Like, there was all these things that start going through your mind. I literally did what he requested, which was slide it open and slide it in there. So then my question becomes, how do I know that my vote was casted? And that you don't have a backup? I mean, these are things that as a traditional voter, you just want to know the answer to. And honestly, until you're in that situation, you don't even think of that. So that, for me, I don't believe we have free and fair elections, if that's what I am faced with. That's all I want to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. McCray.
Yes, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Thank you for having us all here. My name is Agnes McCray. I'm a human rights advocate, a long time. I'm a resident of Syracuse, but most importantly, when I became a citizen of the United States in 1999, the first thing I wanted to do was cast a ballot, and that was way before the HAVA Act that came into play in 2002. Being a voter is very important to me, not because of just the right to vote, but it's my strongest voice and my best ally for changes and progression in my community, so I take it very seriously. I appreciate all what the HAVA Act brought that was passed, but I've heard a lot of spoken word about the absentee ballot, but I have never voted absentee. I've either gone to the polls, and now I've been using the ballot marking device, which is known as the DNB. I was one of only three selected from Syracuse and New York to go and have to choose that machine, which was easier once the HAVA Act was passed. I also helped to develop the sensitivity training that New York State now uses. So it's very important to me as a citizen, as a parent, as a person with extraordinary differences. But I have to say that for the past 15 years or so, maybe. Oh, and I can't forget to say that I've been in the training classes with the Board of Elections as well to train the poll workers. So, and it's something that I take seriously, but for the past 16 years, I have gone to my polling place and the machine is never ready to go, never set up. They're supposed to be able to set it up, run through the machine, and to make sure it's working. And it couldn't be more prevalent than in this election. When I, this last primary, I went to vote. The machine was not set up. And it gets to the point where sometimes they don't even know that a DNB ballot, ADA ballot has to go insert into the machine. And now they are trained machine specialists within those classes that are supposed to know what they're doing, but they don't. It doesn't matter to them because I get to hear, oh, you're the only one coming, so why should we set it up? I am the only one coming, but shouldn't I be, don't I have the right to vote and choose in what form I would like it to be? This last time that I went to vote, I couldn't even get past the instructions for the three different devices that the machine has when you vote on the DNB side. Once I got to the third said the machine went blank more than five times. All of a sudden, they couldn't figure out it out, so they called everybody. And the three people came out trying to fix this machine, wondering why it's not working. They put three different ADA ballots in there. You only have three chances to put the ballot in there. And finally, after 45 minutes of just waiting, I say, I told my children who vote with me, because now they're old enough to vote and cast their own ballot, and we all live in the same area currently. So I'm a proud parent. I'm getting my children and my family out voting. But in this election, I had to end up voting regularly. And they didn't, no one knew what to do. So after I voted, I told my children, my son who is right here, who I wanted. And we went to, so I had to cast my ballot in the regular way. What I wanted to say is that before I left, the poll inspector said to me, well, the machine is working now. We don't know what you did. And from where I'm standing, I couldn't see what you were doing anyway. And that's always the same thing that I get to hear all the time, because it is never ready to go. And it's a big fiasco. Now, in the classes, they are told and they're trained that, you know, when your machine specialist check the machine when it gets there, I don't want to be the scapegoat. I shouldn't be made to feel that absentee is my only choice. You know, they need to be up and ready to go. What has to happen? Because as always, I'm coming with a solution, is we need to find a way to get more poll workers involved in doing the work. Because what happens is who is trained and who actually shows up on election day to work the polls is two different things. So I just want to just thank you all.
Thank you very much. I'm just going to exert the chair's privilege for a second. I will allow my colleagues to ask a couple of questions. One to Ms. McCombie, if you can, you don't have to do it now, but hopefully you can talk to our staff just about the specifics of your situation. I'd love to know more about that so that we can follow up. And to Ms. McCray, we are very grateful for your testimony and for your time today. I think I hear a Caribbean accent.
Yes.
Is that correct? What country did you come from?
Yes, you do. My family is originally from Trinidad, but mostly settled in a country called Guyana.
Okay. So. All right. Excellent. Excellent. So I just wanted to note that for our Caribbean massive out there. And so thank you again. And I would offer my colleagues the opportunity to ask a question, starting with Senator Mannion.
Thank you. And I may ask for at the end of this a bit of privilege as well. Ms. McCombie, I experienced a similar situation to yours, almost exactly, you know, so I can understand the frustration that both of you share. I went to my polling site, which was always my polling site. I went to use the scanner, and it did not work. And I had the same exact scenario where I then had to place the ballot into a box and leave. and I lost that election by 2%. So we all, as members of a democracy, have a lot at stake. I had a little more at stake that day. But I relied on the experience and the trust of the commissioners that were out there and the people that they trained to do the work to make sure that we have fair and valid elections in this state, in this county, and in this country. So my request for privilege would be, I think, considering the seriousness of people wanting to know that there is a proper process that is completed to assure that all votes are counted, is it possible to allow some of the members that are Democratic, or I'm sorry, apologize, elections commissioners or deputy commissioners was what I was trying to say, not to put them on the spot. Some of them are still remain to respond to that. And that would be that's my request, that I think in a public setting, if there's willing participants out there to provide that background.
Yeah, and so I think for those who have remained, I think we might be able to accommodate that, and certainly because we've had some folks who did not show up to testify. So if you are in that category and willing to respond, please do let one of the staff members know. Senator May.
Thank you, and thank you both for your testimony. Agnes, so I need to say, the last time I saw you were in Albany testifying just last week on the long-term care workforce, and I am so grateful for all of your efforts to educate us about the issues that you face. And this one in particular, I wanted to mention that when I was in DC yesterday for the voting rights rally, I met a woman who is an advocate for people with disabilities in an election law, and she was particularly concerned about the some of the federal elections bills that are out there that would require all paper ballots or universal paper ballots. Is that the phrase? Because she said that there are people who have visual impairment, there are people who can't fill out a paper ballot themselves and they have to rely on someone who's assisting them, and they can't check if that person actually filled the ballot out the way they wanted it filled out. And I just wonder if you have any thoughts about that issue.
Well, also with that as well, it's very hard to do that because you cannot go outside the line. There's a very particular way that has to be done in the circle, or else the ballot becomes invalid. So, and if you have extravagant differences, as most people do, it's hard to hold a pen and do that. Or especially also for persons with vision issues. So that might.
So I guess the follow-up is, there certainly are circumstances where someone needs assistance, and what has been your experience with that? How do you guarantee that person is actually following your wishes and not their own wishes in terms of how the ballot should be completed?
So what normally would happen is that person then has a right to know how they're voting so that they can take someone with them that they trust. I know when I had to vote with the paper ballot this last time, I had a person from both parties talking with me on either side. And so that's also, And that might be a challenge and a big issue for some as well. And if I may just touch on the electronic poll book for a moment, because that has to be so straight on the stand in which you write your name. And so it may be a challenge for some persons who have not enough hand strength or cannot hold a pen depending on what their extraordinary differences. Well, and I know for some people they have stampers, but a stamper is something with a person's name on it, and that's not allowed to use in the poll books. But maybe, you know, and again, it's a person that you can take with you that you trust, but it's also making sure that the Board of Elections are giving the individuals the right information when they get there as well. Because people are, they tend to be very thrown when they see a person with extravagant differences of any kind coming to vote. You know, the only what they see is the absentee. So again, it's training and it's trusting that they know that what they're doing and what they're saying, and they must always give a person a chance to ask questions so that they're comfortable and secure in what they're doing.
Thank you.
And their polling place should also have that information to give. So okay. These are the choices. And you have, this is how you can vote, and this is what you do. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Senator Rath.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Ms. McCombie and Ms. McRae, for your comments, your testimony, and your perspective. I think it's very interesting, the experiences that you both had. And the reason why I say that is because this is exactly the kind of information that we need to be hearing about, sitting on the Elections Committee and being state senators, to know the challenges that you faced. And I heard cases as well in my hometown of Amherst where scanners were down for hours on end. And this was during early voting, and that just extended the line further and further and further to the point where it was 4 hours to wait at times in my hometown of Amherst. And when we have these challenges with our machines, it erodes the trust and the confidence that people have in the voting process and in the voting machines that they are normally scanning their ballots into. And people were having to put them into boxes, and they would say to me, I'm not sure that my vote is counted, and I'm not sure that I trust the system right now. So we have work to do to, I think, make sure that we have adequate backup equipment and scanners, and also that we have adequate training for people with disabilities who are coming in to cast their ballot just like everyone else, and should have more than enough training and more than enough equipment and processes to help you in your right to vote. And I want to also thank Ms. McRae for your advocacy and your leadership and the work that you have done to make sure that in New York State we are focused on the challenges that people with disabilities have and the difficulty to vote, which is very real. You are exactly the kind of people that we need raising your voice and making a difference in our communities. So thank you very much. No questions, just comments, but I really appreciate both of your testimony. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Rath, and I would echo the sentiments of all of my colleagues in thanking all of you for your time and your testimony to Ms. McRae, and thank you to your son, who's being a good son and being helpful today. Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Next up, we will hear from Mark Matt, Angie Renna, and Russ Penner. Mr. Matt, whenever you're ready.
Thank you very much. Appreciate being here today. Actually, I'm going to talk a little bit about something that most of you haven't heard about, because what I'm going to speak about is actually not under New York State election law. It's actually under New York State village law, and it has to do with their elections. This past year, I happened to live in the village of Fayetteville, and there was an election for the mayor and two trustees. That obviously was, everything was put in early. We were going to have it in March, and that was postponed because of the pandemic. But they all did the petitions and everything else, just like all villages do across New York State. That was put off until September, and that election occurred. Now, in that time period, there was a person I know who actually wanted to run for town board. And the problem with that is you're past petition time, but so, okay, we can do a write-in situation. So she talked to the village clerk, et cetera, in order to set it up so they could do that, and that wasn't a problem. However, I happened to get my absentee ballot, and there was no provision for a write-in listed on the absentee ballot. And when I spoke to the people doing, who went and did their voting live, they asked how to do an absentee, how to do a write-in vote, for gosh sakes, and no one could give them any instructions on how to do that. Now that was sort of amazing. Then we'll put a little bit on top of that piece of pie, and we're going to say when they collected the ballots, they put them all into a large trash can to be counted later. Now that's not really the best thing for what we would call what we think confidence in vote. Okay. Now, let me just be clear about this. This is no way is against New York State election law. This is all under the village law dealing with elections. And the villages allow, under village law, village officials and their appointees conduct the elections in order to elect themselves. That is one of the particular problems. Now, the person who ran on the write-in did not, in fact, win, which is not unusual in write-ins, by the way. Let's be serious, okay? So that piece doesn't really bother me so much, except that what happened was is the people in the village were very much dismayed and concerned about the fairness and transparency of their elections and whether their vote matters. Now that's the part that really bothers me. Now many of those people in the village, they talked to the village officials and they were really animate about what was going on. And so it was very difficult. And the village officials heard this and they knew exactly how they felt about it. This past July, I actually spoke to the mayor of the village and explained to him what was going on. And we talked about what their options were going to be. And they were going to, in fact, go to the local board of elections and hire their equipment. They were going to solve part of the problem, what I call the trash can problem. They weren't going to solve the real problem. The real problem is the transparency and the fairness of the election. I spoke to him about that, et cetera, and we had a really good conversation. And just a couple weeks ago, the village, actually the board of trustees and the mayor all voted in order to work with the local board of elections in order to have them run their elections, which I think is a really a big plus, because now we know we have an independent body working on the elections. Now, there's an additional cost to the village by the board of elections. In our area, we probably have only about three or four villages that actually utilize the Board of Elections for elections. Now, that produces a problem because now we're charging additional for people in order to run fair and transparent elections. And that's sort of a problem that I look at. I also know that we have a bunch of other things going on because what we're really looking at is we're looking at the Boards of Elections are all funded basically, some funds from the state, but for the vast majority are actually coming out of the counties. And that really restricts what they can do. Because democracy does have a price. We all know that. But when we can't have democracy, even at our local level, and we charge additional to have fairness and transparency of our elections, that creates another issue that people really wonder, is this really what it's about? And when we start looking at elections, that becomes the issue. So when I look at it, I basically have two recommendations. If, in fact, we should take a look at village law and maybe move that so that it is in fact where Board of Elections do take care of it. And what happens now under village law is that they do the petitions, et cetera, they all go through the village. It's all handled by village officials. And it should be handled by Board of Elections. If in fact they don't wish to do that, and there is a real problem as far as many villages want to have their independence, I have no real issue with that necessarily. But if they're going to do that, then we should allow additional funds for Board of Elections in order to be able to handle the additional costs rather than charge the villages. Because many of them don't want to go to a November election. They don't want to get lost and be the 47th item on the ballot. because if people say, well, there's no turnout, the problem is we got to have candidates and we got to have a view of fairness of the election. And if we're talking about we want turnout, then we would have every election just be on presidential elections, because that's the turnout that we have. That's when real turnout occurs. So we'd have to turn everything to 4 years for everybody across the board. So that's what I look at. So those are my two recommendations. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Angie.
Thank you, Chairman Myrie. Thank you, Senators Mannion, May, and Rath. I appreciate you providing this opportunity for voters to voice the concerns and share their experiences as it relates to the 2020 election and also for future elections. My name is Angie Renna. I was a 2020 candidate for New York State Senate in the 50th District, and today I come before you as a concerned citizen of the 50th Senate District, as well as to share my election experience as a candidate. I actually had an opportunity to listen to previous testimonies from the hearing in Brooklyn, which I found very interesting. I think it was 3 hours and 44 minutes long, but I hung in there till the very end. And it seems appropriate more than ever to hold these hearings and learn from the mistakes and the inefficiencies that are being made, not just in the latest New York City mayoral primary, but also across the state. As a new candidate to the political landscape, I was shocked by how things are run and managed behind the scenes, something I know the average voters are not informed about. In previous testimony, the committee heard about the numerous problems of staffing the polls, training poll workers, and even the egregious testimony of falsely identifying poll workers by providing them with a name tag, using opposing party affiliations to create the appearance of bipartisan representation at the polls on Election Day. I wasn't going to talk about ballot challenges, but since Senator Mannion has alluded to it a few times, I did want to touch on that. During the 2020 election, mail-in ballots overran Board of Elections across the state. The understaffed and underfunded offices could in no way fully verify each and every ballot that came in, run checks against voter rolls and death records, and validate signatures of absentee ballots. And let me just share with you a few numbers that I thought were of interest to demonstrate what that looks like. Of course, it doesn't want to bring it up now. In 2018, there were a total of 10,200, and this information, by the way, is coming from the Board of Elections. In 2018, for Onondaga County, 10,281 mail-in ballots were received. In 2019, 3,788 mail-in ballots were received. In 2020, 57,203 mail-in ballots were received. That represents 1,500% over the previous year's mail-in ballots. So my question is, was there a 1,500% increase in the local BOE's budget? Was there a 1,500% increase in staffing to review those ballots and to ensure their validity? Was there a 1,500% increase in training of poll workers and staff to know how to look at those ballots when they came in? And I can answer probably for the panel to say no, there wasn't. So as a candidate, it's my right and my responsibility for the 74 plus thousand other voters that voted for me to make sure, as is the right of any candidate, to ensure that those ballots were gone through the process that they needed to go through to make sure that we are, in fact, ensuring free, fair, and accurate elections. It's not favorable. No one likes to do it. My campaign didn't like death threats. We didn't like to be run through the mud in media, but it was part of the process because in our district, it's pretty well close to half and half. So for whoever is elected, you're representing not just Democrats who voted for you, but you're also representing Republicans. You're also representing conservatives. You're also representing the Working Families Party. And everyone's voice matters. Everyone's vote matters. And we want to make sure that that vote counts. During my campaign, as I went door to door, I knocked on doors of using voter rolls from the BOE of deceased voters. I knocked on doors of residents who no longer live there and have, and you're shaking your head because I'm sure we're all going through this as a candidate. These are experiences of a candidate's life. That is why it's important to question how we're going to handle mail-in ballots, especially if it's a no-excuse mail-in ballot situation. In the 2020 election, the governor made an executive order to allow for mail-in ballots. He also made an executive order to allow voters to apply for absentee ballots via a web portal without a signature. This eliminated a safeguard in the election process. The EO even allowed an individual to request an absentee ballot over the phone. This is an unconstitutional move, which led to more than 16,000 ballots just in the 50th Senate District alone to come in without means of any voter ID verification process. These were 16,000 votes that under state constitution could have been disallowed. I would like to implore the committee to maintain the integrity of our election process and require voter identification at the polls, as well as during any mail-in ballot process that you consider as a committee. According to a Monmouth University poll released 21 June of 2021, 80% of Americans support requiring voters to show some type of ID at the polls to vote. In New York State, voter signature is required to be reviewed. That begs the question as to how a proper verification process was followed to allow for 16,000 votes that came in by web portal or by phone. It wasn't and it couldn't. I'm asking the committee to make a consideration in requiring some type of voter identification during our election process. Again, I want to thank the committee for hearing the testimony today. You are each tasked with the most important role as an American and as an elected official to uphold our United States Constitution and the New York State Constitution. Our election process is the envy of the world and must remain a fair, free, and transparent process so that when the results are tallied, the voters have no doubts as to whom the winner. We have been lacking that for many election cycles. This is an opportunity to work together in a bipartisan manner to achieve greater voter access, to provide a stronger accountability of the process, and to deliver accurate results. In the end, the Board of Elections, the Election Committee, and you as the elected officials should act in the best interest of all of the voters. I pray you do just that as you move forward and consider the testimony of the many constituents who had the courage to come before you to speak. God bless you all.
Thank you, Mr. Penner.
All right, I want to thank the senators for being here to hear about the essence of our democratic process. I want to thank the people behind me who are here, presumably on their own dime, to take part in this process and be part of things. I appreciate that. I want to talk about a different side of voting rights. So the right to go in and vote is a very important part of our system, but the right to vote can be undermined if there's an authoritarian structure that decides who's on the ballot in the first place. So I'm going to address a lot of the things that Mr. Hawkins talked about as far as access to the ballot. Part of an open democratic system is not just the right to vote, but the right to run for office, to support different candidates for office, even to come together with other like-minded people and form a party and become a recognized party if people feel the same as you do. So those are important parts of it. And as his statistics pointed out, New York is restrictive to that. There were thresholds established before the gubernatorial election of what it would take to become a registered party for the four-year cycle, and two parties put a lot of work into meeting those thresholds, and then the establishment changed the rules partway through those 4 years and disallowed that recognized party status that those two alternative parties could had earned. Do you ever go into the voting booth and there's only one person running for an office? And it's like, this is what my rights are. I can either rubber stamp this person or not, and they're going to win anyway, so it really doesn't matter an awful lot. That's not the ideal of our system. And we need more candidates on the ballot, not less. I've never been bothered by having too many candidates, so it seems like we ought to be moving the rules toward an open, more open ballot access than trying to close them. I think it's almost as bad to have the same old two parties represented on the ballot with the same old conservative liberal rhetoric going back and forth, and the goal, of course, to just demonize your opponent so that more people hate and fear your opponent than hate and fear you, and then you win the election and you get to do it all over again. I don't think that's the ideal of our system either. I think more voices ought to be heard, more viewpoints ought to be involved in the process, and people with different ideas ought to be part of that process as well, and our voting and ballot access rules ought to reflect that. The existing Congress voted themselves access to campaign finance funds from the taxpayers' pockets, so even if you're smart enough not to donate your money to campaigns, they'll get some of your money anyway through the taxes. And they seem to think that the best way to safeguard the taxpayers' money is to make sure all of that money stays with Democrats and Republicans, and that if 10% of it went to independent or other party candidates, that would be a waste of the taxpayers' money. But the rest of the money that's going to Democrats and Republicans apparently isn't, and I don't think that's a good reason to close down the openness of the system. So I would call on the current legislatures to do a few things. One has been addressed already with the petitioning process, that we're still doing this burdensome and unverifiable paper signatures process, which is sort of behind the times. So getting an electronic petitioning process so that people can log in and show their support for people that they'd like to see on the ballot in the primary. I think that'd be a very simple thing to do electronically, and it would be more secure than the current system. But also call on you to look at undoing part ZZZ of the budget and the thresholds that are there to lower the threshold so that we can have more voices or more people participating in that process.
Senator Rath.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you to you three as well for your testimony and taking time to share with us your perspective. Angie, I want to touch on your voter ID question, which I think is an important question to ask, and it's one that is certainly on the minds of all of us. Over 70% of U.S. states in our country have some form of voter ID, and I'm familiar with the Monmouth poll of over 80% support of that in some form through that recent research. And there's two pieces of legislation. One is a proposal from Senate Minority Leader Rob Ort, which is currently before the Elections Committee, and I'm actually drafting a piece of legislation myself with regards to voter ID. So we are aware of it. We are putting forward proposals, and we'll see where it takes us.
Thank you, Senator. Good luck with that.
Yep.
Thank you all for your time and your testimony.
Thank you.
So our last panel for the day will include Mark Brayman, Montanette Murphy, and we are bringing back up Michelle LaFave in her capacity as commissioner to answer the question that Senator Mannion had posed earlier. So you're Mark. Okay, I'm assuming Montanette. Last call for Montanette. Great. So Mark, we will you will be the last official testimony for today, and then Michelle, you can speak to Senator Mannion's point whenever you're ready.
I want to thank the senators, and especially my Senator Rachel May. I'm a resident since 2001 of Madison County of Cazenovia. I actually grew up in a very bipartisan household. My father was a lifelong Democrat, born on Sutter Avenue in Brooklyn, not probably either in or not far from Senator Myrie's district. And my mother was a lifelong Republican, as was all her family. I was a Democrat until 1992, when I had been a delegate to a congressional district caucus and saw some things that bothered me about the way the Democratic Party functioned. And so I've felt that it was necessary to get active outside the Democrat and Republican parties. In 1998, I joined the Independence Party of New York. When I moved back to New York State, I eventually rose to become a member of the County Committee of the Independence Party, but switched to the Libertarian Party in 2016. I am now on the State Committee. I was an elected delegate to the State Committee, elected in the June 22 primary. So I have a couple very specific things. I hope you will appreciate my testimony for suggesting some very specific changes in election law. The first pertains to Section 3-400, which provides not for bipartisanship in county commissioners, but in election inspectors and clerks. About a year ago, there was a big public push from the State Board of Elections and from public media that there was going to be a need for more commissioners, more inspectors, because many of the inspectors were older and were concerned about participating during COVID. So I volunteered for that with my county commissioners, and I got back an email, which is actually posted on my website now, markbrayman.com, saying that I was ineligible unless I decided to switch my party to Democrat or Republican. Of course, that was impossible because I would then have had to resign from the state Libertarian committee. I think that Senator Myrie mentioned that in downstate New York, the board feels free to appoint people who are not equal numbers of both Democrat and Republican parties. Apparently, upstate New York commissioners don't feel that freedom. I think that while I am not with many of my other Libertarian state committee members in supporting Howie Hawkins' proposal to go to a nonpartisan system for county commissioners, I have interacted very well with county commissioners, and I think the bipartisan structure makes sense for that, where you have so few people. But I don't think it makes sense for all the election inspectors to have to be either Democrat or Republican. In Madison County, nearly one quarter of the registered voters are neither Democrat nor Republican. And I think it's incredibly unfair and frankly unwise to prohibit people who are Libertarian, Green, Working Family Parties members to participate in the election inspection and clerk system. It could be, since there are four inspectors per district and up to two clerks, it would easily be possible to require just one inspector and one of each of the two major parties, and the other inspectors and clerks could be either unregistered, unaffiliated, or from minor parties. Especially as we move to increased numbers of voting days, the number of hours that these inspectors are going to have to be work and to be paid for is going to go up. It already went up this past election. It wasn't a major factor in my volunteering because I was full-time still at at Syracuse University in the chemistry department. But I felt I had competence. I have lots of experience. I can go over with you with elections going back to 1972 when I was a 15-year-old and canvassed for George McGovern in the Brighton area of Monroe County. So I think it's unwise, especially last fall. It seems that this shortage of election inspectors may have contributed to the overburden of work. I spoke with, in February, I spoke with Rose Grimaldi, one of the election commissioners of Oneida County, and asked her her opinion of whether that was a contributory factor in the overburdening that made it impossible for them to count adequate registrations. And she didn't want to say it was specifically. She said there was just a general overburden of work. So I do think it is something that overall is unwise. Those several hundred election commissioners in each county will serve as an effective check and potential watchdog on the bipartisan election commissioners, making it less necessary to have quote-unquote nonpartisan commissioners. I think they can serve a good check and as whistleblowers. And there's no reason to exclude one quarter of at least our county from being able to get some of the money that is being used to pay for these election commissioners. Excluding one quarter of the registered voters from those positions is somewhere between idiotic and possibly corrupt to provide such a large fraction of the state budget that you're excluding people from participating in. So that section 3-400 is the one, first one that I suggest to change. The other thing that I've discovered is that, and connected to that is the problem that that causes with willingness of people to perceive our election system as good, as fair. One of the things that I've discovered in inspecting the results from the New York 22 result is a fact that is sort of been buried by election boards and with the somewhat laziness of the journalists in the state. They record that 49% of the vote went to Claudia Tenney, 49% to Brindisi, and 2% to our Libertarian candidate, Keith Price. But that's actually incorrect. In fact, the results of the ballots that were turned in, the valid ballots, was 47% to Tenney, 47% to Brindisi, 2% to Keith Price, and nearly 4% of the legitimate ballots that people were able to get and cast included a vote for no one for Congress. And this is something that should equally concern our representatives in the state Senate and Assembly. Why, in a race that was determined by 109 votes, why there were some 12,000 people who turned in active ballots for one of the most consequential races in the country, turned in no vote at all? Of those people who voted for Anthony Brindisi, some 5,000 of them, I'm sorry, of those people who voted for Joe Biden, some 5,000 of them left blank the Congress race, okay? Compared to the 109, I keep on wondering why those people didn't vote. For that answer, I can sort of imagine that there were some people in working families parties who voted for Joe Biden and didn't see a working families party candidate for Congress, and so they decided not to vote. But for the Republicans, some 5,000 or 6,000 people voted for Donald Trump for president and left blank a vote, did not vote for Claudia Tenney. How does that make sense?
Mr. Brayman, we've given you a couple minutes over time, so if you could just move to close in the next 30 seconds, please.
So the other part that needs to be, that people need to be made aware of is that over 2,000 people who are registered in Congressional District 22 as active voters are also simultaneously registered in other districts in the state. And this should be an item of concern, because this is comparable to the number who weren't allowed to vote even though they registered. So the other recommendation I would have is that the state legislature should assign the task of keeping voter rolls to the state Board of Education rather than to the county boards. The county boards are doing an inefficient job of purging voters.
Thank you very much. And Ms. Lefebvre.
Yes.
Senator Mannion, I don't know if you want to repose the question.
First of all, I want to really say I appreciate the comments, but I appreciate you coming back and know that there were several representatives from boards of elections out there. And lucky for you, you were willing to participate again after some of them, and this is a long hearing, had left. So I can't express my appreciation greatly enough. I do feel very strongly about many of the things that were discussed today, but particularly where we sit as a country right now. And I try to do whatever I can to block the perpetuation of the narrative that our elections are not free and fair, and that the people that are doing the work are doing a very good job in this state despite many challenges, and I've heard those challenges. So I experienced this, as did Ms. McCombrie, which was that my ballot did not go through the scanner. So what is the process and potentially safeguards that exist when that exact situation occurs?
This is an issue that happens quite often, unfortunately. There are 100 different reasons as to why. With it being an optical scanner, it could be something as the printing not being dark enough in the timing marks around the ballot. It could be the way that it was ripped out of the ballot booklet and there was a little extra fuzz. It could be something that had gotten on the Mylar that's inside the scanner. When that happens and the machine spits the ballot back out and it won't take it, the poll inspectors are supposed to go into emergency mode, so where they open the emergency ballot box, which is right underneath where you would scan your ballot, it's locked. They have the key. They do this as a bipartisan team. And then the voter can place their ballot inside the emergency ballot box until one of us from the office can get out to the site and either fix the problem or give them a brand new machine. When those ballots have been cast, they stay in the ballot box. Once the issue is fixed or the new machine is up and running, that ballot box is locked. At the end of the night, after the polls, after 9 o'clock when voting is done, as a bipartisan team again, the inspectors will take those ballots out, try to refeed them through the scanner. Hopefully they'll scan and read then. Anything that doesn't scan afterwards gets counted by hand and added to the machine totals at the end of the night.
And the counting by hand is done by a bipartisan team?
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome.
Thank you both very much for your time and your testimony. So that concludes the witness portion of the of the hearing. I would offer my colleagues the opportunity to give closing statements, and we'll start with Senator May. We'll proceed to Senator Mannion and close with Senator Rath.
Thank you so much, and thank you, Senator Myrie, for bringing this show on the road. It is so important that we be able to hear from voters where they live and not expect people to all come to Albany or go down to New York City for hearings. So I'm really proud that we've been having these hearings across the state. I'm grateful to you, grateful to Senator Rath and Senator Mannion for your good questions and your attention to these issues. I do want to pick up on something Senator Mannion said, which is we do have a crisis of confidence in our elections right now. It is being deliberately sowed as a way to make people believe that our elections are not trustworthy so that there can be measures taken like sham audits of elections or even a what we saw on January 6th in Washington, D.C., where certain people took it in their hands to try to overturn the results of a U.S. election and prevent the peaceful transfer of power. I think this is a moment where we need to stand up and we need to be fixing the problems where they exist, but also to be acknowledging that the people who are doing the work of our elections and election administration are doing their very best, and that the actual cases of fraud in our elections are almost so rare as to be extremely difficult to find. So I hope that people take away from this testimony a sense that we are working to fix the problems where they arise, but that in general, our elections are something to be proud of, and that the results of our elections are something we can really trust. So thank you again for holding this hearing and for all of you who've been here to testify.
Thank you, Senator May. Senator Mannion.
I thank everybody who testified today, and of course I thank Senator Myrie and all members of the Elections Committee. We live in a very diverse state, and there's a lot of diversity of thought. And what particularly resonated with me were the comments from individuals that represented minor parties, and that there needs to be access that is reasonable and voices to be heard. Additionally, hearing it from, you know, representation standpoint as it relates to Board of Elections and inspectors certainly resonated with me. Another thing that resonated was that the funding needs to be there, period. And that we cannot exist in the state in a one-size-fits-all model, because Senator Myrie's district is so different from mine and so different from Northern New York. And when we talk about village elections, or we talk about, you know, national elections, it is very challenging, I think, even to put into legislation to make sure that we don't overburden certain municipalities with costs, yet we make sure that everyone has access to those things. So that is something I take very seriously and appreciate all the testimony today. I will double down on Senator May's point. I know what it's like to lose an election, and I know what it's like to win one. But I know I want my children to exist in a country where we do not have state legislatures overturning elections. That is where our democracy is not on the pathway to being lost. It is a pathway that has ended democracy. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Mannion and Senator Rath.
Thank you very much, Chairman, as well as my fellow senators, Mannion and May, for this important forum and this very important discussion that we had here today. I got to tell you, a lot has changed in 32 years for me sitting in a classroom at Syracuse University. This is very, very eye-opening for me, very, very interesting. And I will tell you, I took 5 pages of notes on the information that was testified before us today. And those notes for me create awareness, but then those notes create action items. And that's what the testimony did for me today, was to create both awareness and action items on ways in which we can improve our elections processes in New York State. And if there was one resounding chorus of voices that I heard today, it was the need for bipartisanship in our elections processes, in our elections programs, in our elections overall. Didn't matter if you were a Democrat, a Republican, Libertarian, Independent, Green, whomever you were today, everyone was talking about bipartisanship in the process. So that's critically important as a takeaway for me. And one other important takeaway that I wrote down, and I put a big star next to it in my notes, is if we're going to make a change to the election law, we should make a change to fill a need and to improve a service, not to make a change to the election law just for the sake of making a change. So again, this was very eye-opening to me. I appreciate everyone's testimony. I look forward to the roadshow going to Syracuse tomorrow, a little bit closer to my home. Or Rochester, big one. Syracuse today, Rochester tomorrow. You see, you try to make a joke and sometimes it doesn't work out. But again, I appreciate this opportunity and look forward to tomorrow. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you very much, Senator Rath. And thank you, of course, to all of my colleagues. I want to thank the staff again, our staffs, the Senate staff, the technical staff. Thank you very much to ESF for allowing us to be here. And I want to echo the sentiments of my colleagues. This Democratic majority has demonstrated our commitment to ensuring that every New Yorker that is eligible to vote has access to the ballot and that that process is as easy as possible. I'm very grateful to Andrea Stewart Cousins, our majority leader, who thought that it was important that we hear from every voice across the state. And that is what happened today. I was very moved by the testimony from voters, from stakeholders, from our commissioners. We very much appreciate all of that input. I will note for the public that we've also received written testimony, and we continue to make the call out. If you are not able to make our in-person hearings, excuse me, please do send us testimony that is written, because we want to hear from as many people as possible. I'll also note that in September, we are having a quote-unquote more traditional hearing in which we will bring in many of the boards of elections to ask questions about what happened and how we can improve things going forward. As all of us have heard today, there were many issues and there continue to be issues, and I look forward, along with my colleagues, to getting to the bottom of some of the things that we've seen and heard throughout these testimonies. And so Again, many, many thanks to all of you who have showed up today in person to testify. Rochester, we're coming to you tomorrow. Westchester, we're coming to you next week. And so I look forward to hearing that testimony. And again, thank everyone for their time. That concludes our hearing. Thank you very much.